it is an internationalist impulse that is part of what many of us call the Black radical tradition, which is open for all. It's not just for Black people. There's one man I know I've talked to many times who's been in the hole since 1973. The prisoners in the security housing unit are divided by race and region, and this is part of the deliberate plan by the California Department of Corrections, to keep people apart inside. The department innovated this process not just as a reflection of the divisions outside, even though we know that the U.S. is more segregated by race and class now than it was in 1960. They innovated this kind of division inside to break apart radical prisoner organizing that was the hallmark of prisons in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s, as many of you might know, either from memory or from study. And in dividing the prisoners into these groupings by race and region, they effectively established prison gangs inside and then fomented warfare between them. They did this, the Department of Corrections, in order to get the prisoners' minds off the oppressor, the guards, and onto each other. That plus television worked. It worked very well. So the prisoners have been in the hole now for decades and decades and decades. They put forward demands in that their hunger strike was the force behind, asking for rather simple, straightforward things. They asked for a way to get out of indefinite detention without doing one of three things, which are the only way to get out now. You snitch, you parole, or you die. Yeah. Right? They said, we don't want to snitch, many of us will never parole, we're doing life, and we don't want to die in the home. So give us a way to get out. They asked for adequate nutrition, because as the prison system has grown and grown, it has figured out ways to squeeze, and it's totally public. It's totally public, write that down. It's figured out ways to squeeze resources out of the bodies of prisoners so that the resources that circulate through the prison will circulate mostly in the form of wages to both guard and non-guard staff, and to pay the utilities that keep those cities running, because a prison is a city. And the prisoners asked for some other things as well. The Department of Corrections cavalierly refused to meet the prisoners' demands and offered a counterproposal that was insulting at best. However, tens of thousands of prisoners throughout the California state system and some in systems beyond California joined the hunger strike in solidarity with those in the security housing unit. When the Department of Corrections response came out, the department, of course, then hunkered down for some kind of violent uprising. That's not what happened, not surprisingly. The prisoners who are in solitary confinement, who actually spend 23 hours a day locked in their cells, who sometimes get to go 1 hour a day and walk up and down in a little pen that you wouldn't even put your dog into if you had a dog to put in a pen, people who have never seen the horizon in all the years that they've been locked up, those people put together a new set of demands. And their new demands, instead of going vertically up to their keepers, were sent out horizontally to everybody else locked up in all the communities that they came from. And they sent out demands horizontally to end the hostilities between the races. This is huge. It's huge because the people who have been locked inside, who have in one way or another, wittingly or not, participated in the race and ethnic war that the department fomented in order to secure itself as a department, have now seen and refused to be participants in that anymore, and have sent word out to the communities they come from to do the same kind of thing. This is a very frightening thing in the United States of America, where our division is always very important for the security of racial capitalism and the contemporary neoliberal state. So I call that to your attention. The second case I want to describe to you very briefly are gang injunction zones. And these are places that are outside of prisons and jails. They are in communities. It is a form of spatial control that is enacted through civil law, not criminal law, civil law. And what civil law does is to divide up the spaces of the communities, of the cities and municipalities and neighborhoods, where people who have been convicted of certain crimes, some of their associates and some of their associates' associates are forbidden to go. Now, many people imagine that what gang injunctions do is keep, you know, low-income, mostly male, persons of color out of, say, gentrified areas. That's not what it does. Divides up people and separates people from their communities, from their neighborhoods, from their streets, from their households, from their families. That's what gang injunctions do. So people have been organizing all over the United States to fight against gang injunctions, and I don't have time to give you the history of gang injunctions, but it goes pretty much hand in hand with the history of the security housing unit that I laid out for you in the case of the California Department of Corrections. Now, as I think I said earlier, and if I didn't, I should have said, and I'll say again, innocence doesn't save anybody. So making an argument that one is not a criminal, and therefore we know who the criminals are, is not going to save one single person, none of the people we advocate for, and certainly not ourselves. Because if an injury to one is an injury to all, that means, among other things, that the criminalization of one is the criminalization of all, and we should take that seriously. I see that my good friend Fahd Ahmed is here, and he's going to be speaking this afternoon, and he might bring up in greater detail what I will describe to you very briefly. The New York City Terrorism Interdiction Unit, not unlike the Boston one that Nancy was describing, that unit, somebody inside that unit leaked to us on the outside a one-day's brief from that unit to the chief of police, to Ray Kelly. On that one-day brief, one single day, it's 2008, right, Fahd? Like April something, 2008. It started with, in the wake of the acquittal of several police officers in the murder of Sean Bell, the police are to watch a certain independent black mosque. Then it goes through critical resistance, Desi's Rising Up moving. The Gina 6, which is in Louisiana. It mentions by name a number of people in critical resistance and in other organizations. It goes on for 2.5 pages. And toward the end, the target is Muslim student organizations in the City University of New York, and particularly a vacation that a group of students took, that one of the spies went along on, where they went upstate in New York, went rafting, prayed, and talked about religion. That's one day's report. So the connection between all of us and the impossibility of making a bright line between people who have been convicted of crimes and those who haven't should be apparent. Civil death stalks the land. Human rights might be the response to civil death, as Malcolm X argued, but that answer has got to be aspirational civil human rights in the form of abolition, not the scientific sort of human rights that is being practiced today as though there were technical response to every problem. Ida Weitzman calls the kind of human rights that are being practiced today that condone 29 people being killed by a drone, but not 31, lawfare, and we cannot succumb to lawfare in order to try to reach our goals. Innocence is no defense. Abolition is the only offense against the human sacrifice that brought us here together today. Thank you.
Online. You're doing great work. But about a month after I started working with CARE, I got a phone call from one of my uncles. And my uncle asked, you know, I'm wondering if you can help me out with something that happened. He said, the last time I tried to fly overseas to Palestine, I wasn't allowed to board the flight. And I had a couple men talk to me at the airport at Hartsfield International in Atlanta. And they told me, don't worry, if we just have a little moment to talk with you, we can probably clear this all up. You'll be able to fly later. So he wasn't able to fly that day. And he was telling me the story, said the next day, the same guys showed up to his home. And they asked if they could talk with him, and he was more than glad to talk to him. He wanted to find out how he could fly back home. You know, he explained the story. I invited him in. I had my wife make him coffee. We sat in the living room and talked for a while. And then they left and they said, you know, we'll follow up with you. So that's when he got concerned. He called me and he said, you know, what should I do? And we gave them the same description of things we tell everyone in that situation to do. We tell them, you do not have to talk to them, and we advise you not to talk to them. We told them, get an attorney immediately. We can draft the letter for you. We can demand that they respect the attorney-client relationship you have, and only talk to your attorney if they want to meet with you. And we can meet with them and try to find out exactly why it is they're trying to target him, if they are willing to have that meeting. So I wanted to follow up with my uncle. I couldn't get a hold of him for about a month. And after a month, he called me back, and he started off by saying, I hope you don't get upset. But I ended up meeting with them again. And he met with them in their offices. And he told me this time when I was in their offices, they asked me if I'd be willing to take a lie detector test. And my uncle agreed to take the lie detector test. He was adamant, he had nothing to hide, he wanted to clear his name. And he told me they told him that he failed the lie detector test. They said there were a couple of questions that they asked him about, and he said they told him that he didn't answer them correctly. When again, adamantly, he was telling me, I know I did not lie. You know, this story goes on, and I can discuss this with other people if they want to know what they should do in this situation. But, you know, something that struck me when we're talking about communities that are being targeted and oppressed by these policies, the same people that are oppressing them are actually creating distrust and facilitating division within those communities. And when he told me why he didn't come back to me, he told me the FBI agents told him they can't work with CARE, and that if he worked with CARE, it would make things more difficult on him. And while appreciating and understanding the ability of activists and organizations to form coalitions, work together, realize their strengths, I think we should all be concerned about the fact that the same people who we are trying to combat are the same people telling us which partners we should have and shouldn't have. And that element of distrust is something I thought about. I know we're going to talk a lot about policies, but it's important to realize what's happening in these communities. And I know you'll hear about it from other of my colleagues. We still have it going on. I mean, that was my uncle. That was my uncle that chose the word of the FBI over his nephew. And I know a lot of you probably already don't like your uncles, but I thought we had a really good relationship. And the truth is, I've seen it on other levels and in many other cases. I've seen it with some of my own spiritual leaders, imams, leaders of mosques. And I'm not just talking about any leader of a mosque. I mean a leader of a mosque that I went to, that I confide in, that I speak with, that meets with government agents on the side without telling us, and then we only find out about it later through our activism. Or, God bless their souls, we find out about it later when they by accidentally mention the name of a special agent in charge. This distrust is crippling and it's damaging to our communities, and it's really slowing down the progress we could make in combating a lot of these policies that are oppressing and diminishing our civil rights and human rights. And I thought about mentioning that, and I thought about mentioning one other element. Because when we talk about policies and laws, there are sometimes areas like this, the creation of distrust in our communities, that somehow fall outside of policies and laws. It's easy to sign a petition. I'm not trying to belittle signing petitions. It's easy to advocate for causes and advocate for legislation and condemn other legislation. But it's harder to find out what's going on in these communities and how these government agencies are making sure these communities would be weak and unable to combat their policies. And the only other element I wanted to mention, again, in light of my role on this panel, is talking about another issue that facilitates the crumbling of civil rights that's beyond the policies and beyond the laws. And when we talk about American Muslims and the work that CARE focuses on, we actually do see a trend that happens across all communities that are affected by these laws. But it's something that we don't advocate for as much. And aside from creating distrust within the American Muslim community, there's a distrust and a disconnect created amongst the greater American community. And that's through effectively dehumanizing the Muslim community. Now, when we look at what's happening overseas, and we can see some of the oppressive policies that are practiced by our president and by our government, no matter who's in the White House, no matter who's in the Congress, and we see some of the oppressive policies that are impacting foreign nations, We realized that this is facilitated and made much more easier because Americans don't identify with Muslims the way they identify with other people. And if we look at what our media representation is, what our elected officials say about American Muslims, how our police department has labeled Islam and the practice of Islam as criminal activity, and how the FBI continues to manufacture plots centered around the Muslim community, we realize that people can become desensitized to worrying about the American Muslim community. I think we're seeing this happen, and it's incumbent on us as we advocate to be able to stand up when we see things like this happen. Even if it's in our local media, I know recently, just this week, there was a study showing how anti-Muslim groups that had been welcomed into the mainstream media had such an impact on the way stories were reported in the past 10 years. And I know working with CARE, this is a study we're still working on, but in three states now, in Illinois, the state of Washington, and the state of Oklahoma, offices there have documented media of one major news outlet and hosted editorial staff meetings at the end of the year. And in 2012, in one of those states, we found that 98% of the news stories about Islam and Muslims focused on our wars in Afghanistan, Iraq, and foreign problems. And the less than 1% of stories that covered American Muslims were only found in the religion section of those papers. And these are things sometimes we don't notice, but they have an impact on how these policies play out. I think if we realize this and we demand better of not only our elected officials, but of media representation, and even in our own communities, we'd realize that these crowds would get much bigger, that people would identify more with this community and this cause as an American problem. And hopefully the next time CARE representatives schedule a meeting with their senators in Capitol Hill, they won't be assigned to that senator staffer that's in charge of foreign relations.
Customs and Border Protection has grown into the single largest law enforcement agency in the nation. I don't know if that is not injustice. And if it's not, I don't know what we call injustice. Where parents are being stripped away from their communities and their families, being sent back home, there are no notices given to their children. So we've had changes. Back when George W. Bush was president of the United States, we saw massive raids, right? There was all of this attention. I don't know if you guys from Massachusetts and Boston remember the New Bedford cases, right? Massive raids, people huddling in a basement, church basement, trying to figure out who was missing, who was not getting picked up, being picked up from school that day because their parents had been removed. And we've now transitioned into the last 4 years into a situation where perhaps the crisis is not as obvious, not as in your face, but where it's happening. Where about 39,000 people get placed in detention every day. Where 400,000 people are permanently removed from the United States every year. And so there is a moment of urgency now. I had the pleasure of working on this Deferred Action for Our Childhood Arrivals campaign, pushing the president to act and to use his administrative power to stop removing Dreamers from the country. And I admire the president tremendously. But there was a time where we had to decide whether or not we were gonna expose what was happening in this country. So we began to wear Obama Deports Dreamers t-shirts. We went to rallies, we went to conferences where the president was speaking. We told him, yes, you can. We walked in with our t-shirts where everyone was admiring him and we were saying, shame on you, because you could be doing more. And we saw in 2011, in June of last year, the administration came out with the Morton memo. And the Morton memo, for those of you who don't know, was supposed to classify and to prioritize the removal of criminals, in quotation marks. So where individuals who were, you know, just living their day-to-day lives in the United States were not as easily removed from the country. The result of this memo, failure. There was no prioritization happening. The Secure Communities program activated in 97% of the United States and here in Connecticut in February of this year. Sense people's fingerprints to immigration and holds them for at least 48 hours. We also had 287G agreements taking place in localities where it deputized local law enforcement to act as immigration officials. And I don't think it's fair to just sit up here and shame the president. I also think it has a lot to do with the Congress that we have. So when President Obama just recently wanted to do away with 287G or to not renew these contracts or agreements, Congress said no. And actually, we're gonna give you more money to do that, right? So we're looking at what the House looks like, what Republican obstructionism looks like, and I think also the cowardice of some of our Democrats in the House and in the Senate. So it's here, I'm here to talk about these different parts of the government. But I don't want to leave people with this kind of sour feeling that nothing is possible, that everything is terrible, because I don't agree with that. I think that there's a moment of urgency whenever a parent looks at his child and says, I may not come home today. This is who you have to call if that happens. There is a moment of urgency when a father or a mother finds that they have to find out who their most trustworthy friend is and ask them to take care of their child in case they don't get to come home that day. That is the impact that Secure Communities is having in our country. That is the impact that 287G agreements is having in our country. So many of the speakers here talked about what is happening in these communities. What you're seeing in communities is the break of trust between individuals or communities and local law enforcement. So people who go to their work and are sexually abused are not given fair wages, have no one to turn to, or fear turning to law enforcement because they may be deported, or a mother who is physically and sexually abused by her partner cannot call the cops because she fears getting deported, or people who fear leaving their home. This is what happened in Connecticut in February of this year. Immigrants calling each other and trying to figure out whether or not they could step, it was safe to step out of their homes. But I talked about the urgency of now because I think that we have a beautiful moment and beautiful opportunities to expose and to fight for change. That's what happened with Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals. I think now we have an Obama II. I'm happy to see that because his opponent was advocating for policies that push people to self-deport, to make the conditions so impossible for people to live a life of dignity that they would opt to leave this country on their own. And I also feel that we have an opportunity to push for more in 2013. And I don't mean just legislatively, I think also administratively. So to think creatively about ways to solve the problem and to not always be waiting for Congress to act, to look at the president and say, and remind him, you have the legal authority to do X, Y, and Z, whatever it is that you're thinking about for your issues. Use your power, be bold. But it doesn't happen if we don't raise our voices, if we don't expose the issues, and if we don't make our demands loud and clear. It takes more than being in the streets. It takes organizing our local communities, our neighbors, and talking about our stories and the stories of the people who may not have found their voice yet. So I leave you saying that I understand the urgency of now, that I'm also very aware of all of the injustices that are taking place as I speak, but that I'm also very optimistic for what tomorrow may look like, because I've seen change happen before my eyes, because I know that together we can make something better. Thank you.
When I analyze and see, not a single American was killed because of a terrorism plot. And this situation is known to everybody. And FBI and other law agencies knew very well that after surveying, after putting surveillance, all the masks, all the Muslims, all the businesses, all their population, their student bodies, their religious bodies, and everything, they didn't find any trace of terrorism related with that. Then they started inventing fake terrorism plots, where the FBI comes up with a plot. It picks up an informant or informants and trains them and coaches them, and then writes like movies are written and scripts are written, and it executes it and find some fake person, most likely not in sound mind or so, and then they break the case when the case is not going any further, or they think that it's enough to sell in the media or to the politicians or to the public, and they say a terrorism plot was thwarted, it was disrupted, had it gone, it would have done much danger or something like this. So hundreds of plots like this were all planned and executed and broken up by the FBI. So the FBI was the only terrorism organization which conducted any terrorism activities in this country.
More than a dozen national unions, labor unions, were completely destroyed. Tens of thousands of good, solid trade unionists were victimized. Every single major U.S. city in this country had a fully staffed Red Squad whose sole mission was to spy on, disrupt, and deny the lawful rights of labor unions and their dissidents. And for the most part, the labor movement failed to recognize the extent of the danger until it was much too late. Labor still has not yet come to terms with the destruction that was visited on our movement during that McCarthy period, right? That's why we don't see the representation we should be seeing here today from the labor movement. They're gonna get involved again when it's too damn late. And I'm here to tell you, the labor movement still hasn't recovered. It's one of the reasons the Bush administration official, a guy named Brian Tanner, felt very comfortable calling teacher unions terrorist organizations. Terrorist organizations, the teachers' unions of this country. And I gotta tell you, sisters and brothers, my wife is a fourth grade teacher in Danbury, Connecticut. She terrorizes me regularly. Right? She's not a terrorist. And no matter what happens, and we're here because there's a serious attack on our civil liberties. Don't let them take away your sense of humor, whatever you do, okay? What are we seeing today? We're seeing Walmart strikes and strikers and pickets and picketers where working class people are being assaulted, arrested, and detained, right? These are the same events where we encourage brawls, right, and fistfights among customers to get those best Black Friday deals that we can. But you show up for a peaceful protest and you get arrested. That's what's happening in this country today. If you try and exercise your right to free speech, right, just this past week, to speak out against right-to-work legislation in Michigan, you get pepper sprayed, right? That's what just happened. If you attempt a peaceful protest in support of a working class struggle anywhere in this country, you face sister and brother police union members in full riot gear and SWAT teams with rubber bullets, right? This is happening today in the United States of America in 2012. This isn't labor history. This is happening right now. This is happening out there today. Just this past year, we saw the first use of the US military against the labor movement since the 1970 postal strike, right? When the US Coast Guard ships and helicopters were sent out to be used to protect grain shipments and try and break the will of the longshoremen's Local 21 in their action against EGT just this past year. In that struggle, the owner class also enjoyed the full support of our National Labor Relations Board, right? That's an organization that's supposed to protect the rights of the working people. This, and I want to be very clear on this point. That was a very distinct escalation and elevation by the Obama administration. The same guy who told us in 2008 that wherever workers were picketing, he'd put on a pair of comfortable shoes and he would get out there and walk the picket lines with them. Now I gotta tell you, sisters and brothers, I go to a whole lot of actions all around the country. I keep looking for our president on one of those picket lines. I've yet to see him. And you just have to ask yourself, just imagine the direct and indirect effects that these continuing and escalating attacks on the working class is having in our country. Surveillance in the workplace increases every day. Workers in this country are being videotaped everywhere they go on the job. Their emails, their phone calls are being recorded. Their internet activity is being tracked, both on and off the job, by their employers, right? And of course, there's working class rats that are still among us, and they always will be. I try and get union members to attend an anti-globalization rally, right, to discuss about the evils of globalization and trying to protect their own jobs. They're afraid of government surveillance. They're afraid of retaliation by their own government. Workers think twice today before they voice their outrage on a picket line because they think that they may be arrested on trumped-up terrorism charges or that the FBI may raid them at their house. That's happened to union activists in the past few years. Workers are afraid to attend simple organizing meetings about how they start a union because they're afraid someone in the room may be an undercover police agent, right? These are the things I hear as I'm out there talking to workers about unions. We see workers with less protection than we have in this country speaking out all over the world today. Our labor movement in the U.S. needs to find its voice and speak out for the entire working class in this country, both on and off the job. We have to once again wade into this fight. We have to build meaningful relationships with all the organizations that are represented here today and many others. And we have to give a powerful meaning to the proud labor battle cry that an injury to one is an injury to all. Thank you very much.
What they do is they've tried in these very, you know, quite local, so they're not large scale, but quite local and relatively intimate community organizations in cities as far-flung as Seattle and Brooklyn and Los Angeles and so forth. They've worked out, you know, relationships with each other so that if they see that, what's your name?
Julia.
If they see that Julia hasn't been around for a while, and she's acting a little strangely when she's with us, and we're a little concerned because we did get a feeling the things at home were not so great, what they do is they go surround Julia. They make sure that Julia has a social life. They try to figure out if there's anything they can do. And when some things happen, there's groups that do this in Queens all the time, something seems to come up and Julia has a partner who has not been treating Julia all that great, or an abusive child who's abusive toward her or something like that. They talk to that person, they sit that person down and say, we want to make an intervention now because the last thing we want is for you to go to prison. So we want to talk to you about what is going on here, what the problems are, and whether we can help you work them out so that you and Julia can be okay. And they do that. They do that. It's scary, but they do it. And they do it successfully. You haven't yet, and believe me, it'll be all over the front page of the paper. Heard, you know, murder rampage because of, you know, abolitionist intervention in Queens. Right? It hasn't happened yet. And it would be headlines. So it's not foolproof, but it is, in a sense, an effort on the part of people in community, in communities, to reverse engineer what has happened to us politically and socially in communities, especially those that are saturated by policing and criminalization. In communities that are saturated by policing and criminalization, there's one thing that regular sociologists who do nothing but count and do regressions show. They show that if you take two communities that are identical, you call it in my trade twinning, twin a couple of communities, you say, these places are the same size. They have very similar populations, and they do a demographic match. So similar in terms of age, income, race, ethnicity, religion, employment, unemployment, there's education, right? Renters as against homeowners, all right? And this can be done, because places are not as unique as we think they are. I grew up in New Haven. I think it's not like anywhere else on Earth. Not true. It's not even like itself anymore, right? So, all right, see, twin these places. And what they do is they look for places in which there's been significant policing and criminalization and people sent to prison, as against places that haven't. And they study them over the long term. They do these longitudinal studies. They say, what was it like in 1980 and 1985 and 1990? And they use various measures to say, you know, do kids go into the foster care system? Is there this? Is there that? Do people move a lot or not so often? And so forth. And what they find over and over and over again, they find it in Florida, they find it in New Jersey, they find it everywhere they can do this kind of study, is the places that have had saturated policing and prisons are worse off by any measure, including what we would all have to agree is criminal activity, people doing things to each other or to themselves that is against the law, right, as against the places that are also people who are modestly educated, who have maybe insecure employment and so forth, who don't have the cop thing laid out. And so then they ask themselves, well, why would this be? Like, where does this come from? These are good sociologists. They don't just say, da-da, here's my findings, promote me. They say, why would this be? And so then they've done some ethnographic studies, meaning they go into the communities, they talk with people, get a really thick sense of everyday life. And what they find is in the places that are saturated with policing, criminalization, and people being taken out to prison, that people don't trust each other anymore, and they have more and more engaged with each other through 911. Right? That's how, if I want to talk to Michelle, I call 911. Right? I don't talk to Michelle anymore. But in the other communities, I got a problem with Julia, you know, I tried to help her out, she's being kind of a pill. I can talk to Dan and say, Dan, what's going on here? Can you help me out with Julia? And Julia's, you know, extended family will come around and say, please, you know better. Okay. So, you know, I grew up, like some of us who are old heads, grew up being yelled at by the neighbor's grandmother, right? Not your own grandmother who was at work, the neighbor's grandmother. And it never crossed your mind not to listen, right? It never crossed your mind. So those customary cultural relationships are destroyed by policing. Even if the cops themselves live in neighborhoods where the customary relationships are still intact. You understand what I'm saying? So it's not about, is the cop a bad person? It's a structural argument. All right, so that's the long answer of how do you do it. That's how you do it. Yes, ma'am.
Mention a couple of things. Do we have the time?
Yeah.
In my mind, I came to this country in the 60s, and I landed in New Haven, so uh-huh. I've been around since then. Uh-huh. And after the, you know, the whole movement of the civil rights, as a matter of fact, someone took me to Washington for a big civil rights. Uh-huh. I was just green, of course, coming from a foreign country and so on. Uh-huh. And then, though, in the 60s, we saw this movement. There was Malcolm X. There was Martin Luther King. There was Johnson that had signed, you know, the poverty legislation and the voting and everything. And all of a sudden, after they start killing the Black Panthers and weakening with the two assassinations, weakening, comes the 70s, and all of a sudden you see a beginning of criminalization of the Black community. I mean, it was just right in front of my eyes. I couldn't believe it. And then you get to the point where this great president for some people, Clinton, comes around. Mm-hmm. He puts in the three strikes and you're out. And when he was running for president, mm-hmm. he was up in New Hampshire. He cut his campaigning short to do what? To go back to Arkansas and sign the execution of a Black man where a lobotomy had been, you know, performed into him to show how, you know, hard he was on crime. I mean, and this is constantly escalating by making the prisons, I think, also private, money producing money for them and going to the legislators and pressing them to make harsher laws so more people will go to prison so they can make more money out of it. That's my thing.
That's a really good very good rendition of what happened, except for one thing.
Yes.
This is the only thing. What? Okay. What's your name?
Ioana.
Ioana. It would be like Joanna. Ioana. Ioana described what it was like to arrive in my hometown, New Haven, in the 60s, and watch the rise of the civil rights movement, its kind of consolidation in those laws of 64 and 65, simultaneous with the war on poverty, which is kind of part of Johnson the domestic good guy as compared to Johnson the war criminal.
Yeah.
His domestic legislation from when he was Congressperson Johnson through President Johnson generally had a redistribution thrust to it that was substantial. And all of that. And then this turn in the late 70s, right? The war against the Black Panther Party for self-defense,
of course, yeah.
And so on and so forth, right? And then criminalization. And then the assassinations. One of my people assassinated was my cousin John Huggins from New Haven.
Oh, yeah.
My cousin. His mother and my mother's sisters. Yeah.
Mrs. Huggins.
Yeah,
she was
my
a
auntie.
Close friend of mine.
Ah, well, small world. It's a small state. It had to be a small world. Yes. I'm Elizabeth Huggins' niece. Yes. Anyway, no, this is not for TV. Yes. So all of this, it comes very close to home. So all of this happened. I'm going to get to Clinton in a minute. But I want to just talk a little bit about this 60s, 70s move. So it is true that the consolidation of the gains of the civil rights movement, right, of the long civil rights movement, crystallized in 64 and 65, yeah? They did. And the redistribution scheme that was the impulse behind the war on poverty sort of came up out of that same administration and began to spread around the land, just as the New Deal had. Unlike the New Deal, the war on poverty had far fewer impediments for women of any race, and men of color to access the benefits, right? The New Deal was extremely hierarchical in race and job, extremely. And women were like, all women of all races, over here. All right, so back to the 60s. Something else happened in the 60s that happened actually right at the same time that this legislation that was kind of ending the civil rights movement, right, consolidating the gains, around which the war on poverty was being waged. And of course, the mistake, I suppose, was to have called it war. Anyway, you know, how about peace? For the hell of it. and that is that for large banks and corporations in the United States, the big companies that were already, in many cases, multinational, but had multinational aspirations, they hit a ceiling on the rise in the rate of profit at the same time that these laws, the Voting Rights and Civil Rights Act, passed, and at the same time that the war on poverty took off. At the same moment, these companies started to see the rise in their rate of profit begin to flatten off. So they didn't become unprofitable. But that rise that they had gotten so used to from when the U.S. became a lender country in 1913 through the Depression, but then taking off from the end of toward the later years of the Depression, the beginning of World War II, up until the 60s, the rate of profit was just going like this. And it was in that context, indeed, that labor unions, which were completely tainted by business unionism, as my colleague on the panel said, had achieved their greatest gains in terms of wages, benefits, and so forth. Right? Plateau of the rate of profit, the big banks and corporations said, hold it. We signed off on the New Deal because we didn't see an alternative, and we were really afraid of the revolutions in Russia, the revolution in Mexico, and so forth, coming around here. But now, we're not as afraid. Now we're not as afraid. So that stuff that we signed off on, and when I say signed off on, what I mean is they were paying high taxes to fund it. What was the upper marginal tax on income in the 1950s under Dwight D. Eisenhower?
90%.
Yeah. Under Republican president, 90%. All right, so they said, we're not going to pay this anymore. We're not going to do it anymore. And you all, who are political actors, whether appointed or elected, are going to have to figure out how to cover for us, but we're not going to do it anymore. We have the chops to change the tax code through legislation. So all that argument we hear about today, this was quietly achieved already 40 years ago. We're going to change the tax code. We're not going to pay the taxes that we pay. And you explain it to the world however you want. We don't care about that. All we care about is our bottom line. Our bottom line. So that goes hand in hand with the criminal demonization and criminalization, particularly but not exclusively of black people, men and women, criminalization of men, demonization of women, that you were describing so well. And then through the 70s, as jobs leave the United States, that pivotal decade, as Judith Stein argues in her book, where the US went from manufacturing to finance, right, very robust part of the economic activity of the country, is the same time that, again, crime went up, people were unemployed, underemployed, inflation was staggering, the U.S. went off the gold standard, you know, and go on and on and on and on and on. Right? Now, the one thing that you said, and then I'm going to get on to Clinton, that isn't true, it's one of the big myths around prison in the United States. There are two big myths. One is that it's private prisons. 95% of all the prisons and jails in the United States are publicly owned and operated. 95%. And the other 5% or so, sometimes 6, depends on what day you count, 5 or 6% are under private management, but 100% of the budget is public money, right? The private prisons do indeed squeeze a profit out of what they get from the state to hold somebody against his or her will, their will, as compared to what they spend on it. This is true. But there are small, say what?
Sounds like charter schools with the public.
Yeah, but it's a small percentage of a bigger problem. And I say that because many, many people say, I'm gonna fight against private prisons, and they organize everybody because it's an easy sell. Isn't it heinous that people make money off of people being held against their will? And it is heinous, right? And then people organize, and the best thing that will happen is that the public entity will take back control. Will one person get out of prison? No, not one. Forget about 5% of prisoners. If indeed organizing against private prisons meant that 5% of the people would get out and figure out another way to be in the world, then I might not be so against that form of organizing, but I'm against it because it's a dead end if your goal is to stop the use of prisons, rather than to stop Corrections Corporation of America and Wackenhut from making a couple of dollars. Now you say, but all that money that goes through prisons, where does it go? Because it's a lot of money. It's a lot of money. As I said in my remarks, it goes to wages, which is half the bill of just about any enterprise, right? Wages. So wages, not just for guards, but for secretaries and locksmiths and janitors and so on and so forth. And it goes for overhead in terms of lights and energy. So utilities companies do very, very well. And a bit of it at the front end, of course, goes to the construction company that builds it. And then a bit of it goes to enterprises, which are generally private, that provide the food, the clothing, telephones are really scandalous, right, and so forth. But it's not a privatized thing the way people talk about it. And this is always my message. If you forget everything else I've told you today, remember that, right? Remember, the problem is prisons, not private prisons. The other myth, and then I'm gonna call on you and then you, that is really prevalent is that the reason there's so many people in prison is that because the 13th Amendment did not abolish servitude, involuntary servitude in the case of people convicted of crime, they must be in there working for some kind of private entity. They're not. Most people in prison are not doing anything, thanks to Bill Clinton, right? Most people who are in prison, they're not going to school because Clinton X'd out financial aid for prisoners. They're not in the library becoming less modestly educated because the Clinton Prisoner Litigation Reform Act authorized all prisons to take apart libraries. And although prisoners still have a right to law books, they have to know what book they need to get it. They can't just go to the library and look around and take care of themselves, much less books for other purposes. And so forth. The jobs that prisoners do in prison are generally jobs that have to do with the running of the prison. And again, 95% of them are public, right? So they're cooking, they're cleaning, they're doing that kind of work around the prison. There's a little bit of work that some prisoners do at some places, more jails than prisons, like cleaning up along the side of the highway. So you drive along, you see all those people in those yellow jackets, it'd be like a big group of people. And then there's one guy, and you might notice he has a gun. Those are people who are being forced to do that work. But again, this is not so that some private corporation makes money. That's not how it works, right? What happens is, let me think of this. Imagine I am a prisoner, all right? And imagine I'm a prisoner in a maximum security prison. The cost of holding me against my will in said prison, the average around the United States comes to about $50,000, about what it costs to go to Harvard, right? About $50,000. I say what?
For a year, right?
For one year. So I do nothing, right? This is the purpose of prison, do nothing. I can stand there. That $50,000 changes hands because I'm there doing nothing. I don't have to lift my pinky finger for that money to change hands. It goes to the wages of the employees. It goes to the electric company. It goes to the gas company. It goes to the food vendor. It goes to whoever made my prison blues and so on and so forth. That's how the money changes hands. It's through the passive being of the prisoner, not the activity of the prisoner. What we will find are organizations of sheriffs, of police, of prosecutors. We will find these grass top, AstroTurf organizations, like victim rights organizations, very often funded by the unions that represent prison guards and police and sheriffs and so forth. That is like the biggest victims rights organization in California is complete front of the prison guards union, complete, in the same building and everything, front, they don't even pretend. Right? And they do have somebody who really did lose somebody to murder, as I really lost somebody to murder, right? But they have the resources to be very, very vocal in all places and so forth. So we see who the lobbyists are. And then I said there are some exceptions, but even the exceptions are not that notable. So for example, I trace the patterns of municipal finance capitalists who make their living lending money to municipalities, including states. Right? In order for them to make a living, they have to lend the money. They aren't in a position, because of the relationships they have with their licensed stores and so forth, to say, well, California doesn't want my money, I'll put it in a suitcase and take it to Vietnam. Right? Even as fungible, as movable as money is, not everybody who runs money for a living can move it to where the need might be. So much for the brilliance of the market that allocates resources rationally, right? So, what happened in California, for example, and also in Connecticut, and also in New York State, and other places in the Gun Belt, from the early 1980s on, is that municipal finance specialists who have been lending money to states to build hospitals, highways, schools, dams, right? Whether or not you agree with all of those things, that's what they were building. They were building infrastructure for productivity. When they got shut out and were told by state after state after state, municipality after municipality, we can't afford this anymore, we're not going to do this anymore for whatever reasons, then they had to figure out how to make a new market. And when the people who looked at declining crime decided to take credit for that and say, this is, we have achieved this, we're gonna do this. Then the finance capitalist showed up and said, how can we help you? How can we help you, right? Again, I've proved this in the California case, and I have a student who's proving it in the New York case, and it's true in other places as well. What it suggests to me is that the state, right, the set of institutions that add up to that state, Portugal, Canada, so on and so forth, whatever their many weaknesses and flaws are, don't get me wrong, right? I'm not getting all romantic here. But what the state does is it models behavior for the people. Right? Where life is precious, life is precious. That's the best way I can say it. Where life is precious, life is precious. So it isn't as though, it isn't a story in which, in my view, because people there don't kill each other, the government doesn't have life sentences, but rather all of the things that the institutions that comprise the state, through governments left and right, do, right, are reinforcing the idea and modeling for everybody, here, life is precious. And therefore, in my view, where life is precious, and therefore people in their relationships with each other are, they're not saying, oh, the state doesn't do it, so I'm not gonna bop Julia, but there are all of these incentives to be different, right? There are all of these sort of guides that are spoken and unspoken. They go back to some of the things that we were talking about when I described the sort of customary community ways that, we, you know, took care of each other once upon a time, right? So I don't mean to be too romanticized, but I am really serious about this. And here's an indication from the US case that might help us put a sharper focus on what I'm saying. A couple of, God, what are they called? Social psychologists from Yale, back in the 70s and early 80s, did this enormous study. I mean, enormous study, the kind that I can only gag at, because I can't do that amount of work, but I'm so glad people do it. And what they did was they gathered data about crime and violence across, I think it was 114 different countries. They got the data together, and then they did, here's the trick. You gotta make data comparable. You can't say this is different in Canada. It's different in Canada from the United States if you don't know that murder here and murder there are the same thing, right? So they had to sort of make everything comparable, figure out, you know, what laws led to it and what each category was, and they did it with an army of graduate students, right? And then they zapped it with all kinds of statistical testing to say, what explains the fact that the U.S. is the murder capital of this world? What explains the fact that both crime and violence, so they're looking also at violence that does not necessarily resolve in a criminal charge and conviction, but that people report through various kinds of surveys. Why is violence so normalized in the United States? Where does it come from? What is it? And so they tried, and they noticed that there was always a spike in the US at the end of a war, spiking homicide, in particular at the end of a war. And so they said, well, the explanation that would first come to mind is, well, when people are demobilized, they come back to communities, there's competition for jobs, you know, people who have the jobs of those people, because they're, you know, wisely educated men, used to be men in the prime of their life, they come back, those are jobs that they think they should get. Struggle over jobs, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, reintegrating in the community, that must explain it. And they said, well, if that were true, it would be true everywhere. That, you know, people in the military are like people in the military pretty much everywhere. So anyone coming back from a war should go through these same stresses, and the behavior should be the same. If it's just, you know, some natural thing, which it's not. So they tried all different kinds of explanations, trying to look at the differences between and among countries, and here's what they came up with. They came up with the fact that the US, unlike its peer countries, some of which, like, you know, Germany, and well, Europe in general, but Germany in particular, have engaged in incredibly bloody wars in the last 100 years, right? Yeah. Right, 60 million people died in the Second World War, and a lot of that death was in Europe. Half of it was Russian people. That what they found was that whenever the United States goes to war and wins, homicide goes up. And we also know from separate studies that whenever there's an execution, homicide goes up in the sort of region where the execution has happened. Yes. Right. So what does that tell us? It tells us the state models behavior for the people. Right? Go kill people, then that's how you solve problems. You kill somebody, that's how you solve problems. And so it is somewhere in that and the sort of long history of violence, and again, I said I come from New Haven, sons and students, the long history of gun violence in the United States that now is being debated so intensely because of the Stand Your Ground laws in Florida that seem to be the background for the murder of young Mr. Davis and young Mr. Martin, right? That there's something even bigger in terms of our sort of general culture and how in the US, political culture, right, solving problems with violence is completely normal. It's not the exceptional thing that happens. And it's not something that after it has happened, people get together and say, man, we wish we never had to do that again. This is not blaming the veterans. It's blaming the system in which going to war is so normal. And if you doubt me, go back through your history books and see how many minutes has the U.S. not been in a war declared in history. Not many. Right? Not many. In fact, he was mayor of San Francisco, Willie Brown, when Jerry Brown was the mayor of Oakland. So the brilliant black communist poet, Amiri Baraka, wrote the following poem. You got two mayors Brown, one black, one white. So they can rob you in the day and rob you in the night. We, in the various grassroots movements of which I've been a part, abolitionist organizations, building a movement, I should say, of which I've been a part, we have used every tool that we can get our hands on to do the work we want to do. And that includes polls, opinion polls. And opinion polling, as you know, is a really, 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 really slippery slope. But sometimes when the goal is to move legislation as compared to the real goal, which is to get people out in the street, have to go legislation by legislation by legislation, the best way to get the attention of legislators is to show up with a poll. So in California, consistently over the years, people have polled voters, likely voters, right? Which equals, in the minds of elected officials, taxpayers. Likely voters have said, of all the things that money might be spent on, prisons is at the bottom for them. They want money for education, they want money for health, they want money for anything else. They don't want money spent on prisons. And so then we, you know, roll into the state legislature, abolitionists, of course, but we say, look, this is what your people you care about, want. They want you to spend the money on the things we want the money spent on. We're fighting over the social wage, after all, right? That's what the fight is when it comes to budget work. We're fighting over the social wage, what happens to that part of our money that goes there. And you just keep turning your back and saying, prison's not education, prison's not healthcare, prison's not home, you know, home healthcare for elderly people. And one day, a legislative staffer who's been a staff member for 30 years said to us, look, it really doesn't matter what your polls say. What? It really doesn't matter what your polls say. I don't distrust your poll. I am confident that this was as good polling as anybody ever does, blah, 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 blah. And we don't do it ourselves. We, you know, have a reputable polling firm do it, Public Policy Institute of California. That it's only going to matter when somebody is either not elected or voted out of office because that person's reputation is they're too tough on crime. Too tough on crime. And I thought, lesson learned. Now, we still do this. We still say the polls because we tell everybody else, hey, you guys, you know what you think? You think this because here's our poll and so forth. But we also, you know, think about, well, what would that mean? So I will never get involved in a campaign either to elect or de-elect somebody because that's not the kind of political work that I do. But it has occurred to me, something I'll say when the machine isn't on. But there are ways maybe to achieve this kind of goal. Also, one of the things we did in California, I'm really not going to explain it. But also, to achieve some of the good outcomes we had in California, what we had to do, which can't be done in every state equally well, was get labor unions to line up against the prison guards union. And the prison guards union is in California is a standalone union. Doesn't represent anybody but guards and parole officers, right? Period. And they have one employer, the state of California. So they are very, very tight. They have huge dues, and they're only fighting one employer, one enemy. Whereas SEIU, for all of its, you know, I know. But anyway, they've got 500,000 members. There are, you know, hundreds, if not thousands, of employers, so on and so forth. We got SEIU finally to listen to us because they realized that every single time there was a budget decision that took more money away from healthcare and education and so forth, was taking the jobs from their members. And it took us years to get them to the table with us, but we finally did. So our joke was we went from being 6 people to 500,000 and 6 people, you know, fighting for abolition. But what was interesting was all of our years of testifying and messaging and publications and conferences and grassroots organizing and workshops and so on and so forth mattered. Because when the shop stewards showed up, the people who were the shop stewards for the SEIU who work in the prisons, who are secretaries at locksmiths and so forth, showed up. They knew everything that we knew already. They had heard it all. And this was their first opportunity to talk about it. So our work had not gone in vain, even though it felt that way whenever we would go to the legislature and say, hey, and they would say no. I also want to say one other thing, two other things that came to mind, and then we have to end because we're almost at time. And it's actually connecting the gentleman down here's question and the gentleman over here's comments and useful insights. And that is, many people think most of the people who are in prison are there for drugs. It's not true. About 20% of the people who are there are there for drugs, but it's only 20%. Now, the problem with thinking that the whole issue around prison expansion has been driven by the drug war is it leaves 80% of the people who are locked up out of the calculation of what to do about prison. About 20%.
Could you clarify for a second, do you mean only like nonviolent possession of drugs is 20%?
Yeah, you're in prison, you're controlling offense in prison is the worst thing that you did. So if you are possessing marijuana, but you bop Julia over the head, you'd be in prison for bopping.
Right?
All right, so 20% of the people in prison are there for drugs, not for bopping or anything else. All right, do you understand?
Yeah.
In the 60s, however, while many white people were radicalized for a lot of reasons, it wasn't the drug war, because that wasn't even happening yet in the 60s. It was way more about the war in Vietnam and its expression at home. And what happened, one of the reasons the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense was slated for extermination, whereas other black organizations were not, was the politics of the BPP, right? It was their politics. It wasn't simply their being black. It was their being radical, black, anti-capitalist, working hand in hand with radical white anti-capitalist organizations, with radical brown anti-capitalist organizations, who were all brought together, among other things, against the war in Vietnam. Many of the people in the Black Panther Party, like my cousin John, became radicalized while in the military in Vietnam. He was in the Navy in the Gulf of Tonkin, demobilized in Oakland, said, I don't know what that was about, but it's not about me, and then found his way to the Black Panther Party, right, and was dead 2.5 years
later.
Yeah, January of 1969. And so one of the issues that became very clear in the war against the war in Vietnam, in the work against the war in Vietnam, and its connection to what was happening here in the United States was this. The war in Vietnam was waged to make Vietnam a capitalist state, right? That was what it was for. There was no other purpose for that war, none. And every single thing that happened in that war up to the massive bombing, right? To the to village destruction, to the prisons used to pacify villagers, and the, what were they called, those villages that were built? What?
Strategic
hamlets. All of that was to compel people to love capitalism. I don't know about you, but I would never love anything that was dropping bombs on me, destroying my home, killing my community, and making me move, right? But that was what it was. So that was Walt Rostow, and all of those people. All right. Now, one of the things that's very interesting is the question, couldn't the U.S. have just rolled into Vietnam and just thrown a lot of money around to make people love capitalism? Couldn't they have just showed up and just started spending money, giving money away, doing that kind of thing to create the love, right? To get the markets, to what they did in Taiwan. They enforced land redistribution in Taiwan at the end of World War II. Also South Korea. The big landowners were all stripped of their property and forced to cut it up so that the small landless peasants would have land and therefore love capitalism, right? They didn't do that in Vietnam. Now part of the reason they didn't do it in Vietnam was that Ho Chi Minh was determined and the army was determined not to be colonized by anybody anymore. Having kicked the French out at Dien Bien Phu, a battle that nobody thought any little, you know, guerrilla force could win, and they won against those big guns, was something that the Vietnamese were going to do against the United States. But it's also true, and here's where I want to connect what you were saying with what you were saying about the 60s. One of the features of the military-industrial complex is that within that complex, there are bids put out to develop weapons, right? To develop not only the plan for who should die, but the plan for how to kill people. And the plan is always, you know, increasing the industrialized nature of killing. And by that I mean you can kill more and more people with fewer and fewer exercises of human brain and muscle power, right? You don't need all those people lined up as in World War I, you have a drone now. And in the Vietnam War, it was something in between. All right, so the military-industrial complex gathers all this money together in order to build all of this machinery that the United States government buys, single market, monopsonic market, in order to go out and wage war. The producers of those goods, actually those evils, we might say, of that materiel, don't have an opportunity to make it again and sell it again unless it's used. In other words, what we are viewing here from the 60s and now is a central rule of capitalism, right? Capitalism, to accumulate, must disaccumulate. You've got to spend the stuff, sell the stuff, use the stuff to have another round of accumulation. And while, you know, you all know if you have a cell phone that is planned obsolescence is clear and it just stops working pretty soon after you get it, right? All right, for weaponry, it's a luxury like a diamond if it's not used. Right? And you know, if everybody who had diamonds went and tried to sell them at once tomorrow, they would be worthless. They only seem to have value because people don't sell them. But it's that disaccumulation of military, of warfare materiel, which is part of the story that brought people together in the 60s, not the drug war, right? And that we face today, the use of these things, as I said, not goods but evils, in order to not only to make markets, but also to make a market for the producers of that stuff so they can sell it.
So today I want to focus on three main issues. The first is that civil liberties under President Obama is as much in danger, if not more, than it was under President Bush. And I think for those... For those who are becoming more complacent or who think, well, it's better than the other party, I'm afraid if you look at the record, at least with regard to civil liberties, that is unfortunately not the case. The second is because that the American public has been hoodwinked into forfeiting its civil liberties through fear-mongering, that the Muslims are coming for you. And so many Americans unwittingly forfeit their civil liberties, thinking that it won't be applied towards them, thinking that it's a necessary evil in order to protect them from those evil terrorist Muslims, who are then subjected to agent provocateurs, entrapment in sting operations, informant infiltration of mosques, and prosecution for material support to terrorism without having to prove against them that they actually had an intent to support terrorism. And so once the legal framework is created to infringe on Muslim communities' rights in the name of keeping all of you safe, because of course you are different from them, right? It's us versus them. Then they come after you, literally you. This is literally probably the group. Hello to all the JTTF members. Hello to the FBI, hello to the informants. We are here to convert you to be one of us. And ultimately, this culminates into a set of policies and practices that are commonly found in police states, where you have mass surveillance of emails and telephone conversations, where you have criminal investigations without any predicate act of wrongdoing. And all of that becomes the norm instead of the exception. And it's effectuated by the thousands of informants that are now on the FBI's roster that spy on political dissenters, and through the proliferation of spy centers, which are known as fusion centers.
And it's also really great to be part of an event that is grounded in the recognition of how important it is to build coalitions based on the premise that every group in the United States that is engaged in activism against the government to check the government, and that especially is vulnerable to majoritarian oppression, has an equal stake in civil liberties and civil rights, and is equally affected when any one group has their rights abridged. That is a crucial precept for understanding the danger of the civil liberties assault in the United States. Now, I write a lot about civil liberties. I speak a lot about civil liberties. The title of the conference that we're here to convene for is a civil liberties conference. And so there's a lot of different ways to talk about this term civil liberties. It's a pretty complex area. There's a lot of different approaches one can take. But one of the things that I think is so crucial to do whenever I write about civil liberties or talk about civil liberties in an event like this is to take a few minutes and ask the question, what is it that we even mean by the term civil liberties? What is it that that denotes? And the reason I think that's so important is because it's a term that gets tossed around a lot. You hear politicians of all stripes all the time invoking this concept. It's pretty much a cliche at this point. Nobody debates civil liberties. No one ever stands up and says, I just want you to know that my position on civil liberties is that I'm against it. It's something that is just a slogan designed to justify whatever anyone wants to justify. And so it's important to really understand the definition of what this term is. And the good thing about that endeavor, about understanding what the term civil liberties actually is that it is not a very complicated concept. It's actually fairly straightforward. When we describe civil liberties or talk about defending our core liberties or our constitutional rights, all we really are referring to is the list of prohibitions, the list of limitations that we have imposed on the government regarding how they can exercise their power against us. It is a list that we've imposed on them and said, you can never cross these lines if we're to accept the assertion of your authority as legitimate and valid. And the good thing, the further good thing about that endeavor, about understanding what the term civil liberties means, is that we don't have to go out on a sort of scavenger hunt in search of this list of limitations that we've imposed on the government's power. That list is found, it has been assembled all in one place, which is called the Constitution or the Bill of Rights. And the best thing about this endeavor, about understanding what civil liberties means, is that this list of prohibitions, the limitations that we've imposed on the state, are not ambiguous or muddled, nor are they circumstantial or conditional. They don't apply only in times of peace or whenever it can't be demonstrated that national security would be aided by their violation. They are clear and absolute and unconditional. And the way that you know that is simply by looking at the list and seeing what it says. So if you look at the First Amendment, it says, Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech. If you look at the Fourth Amendment, it says, nobody shall be subjected to unreasonable searches and seizures without a probable cause warrant, a warrant issued upon a finding of probable cause. If you look at the Fifth Amendment, it says, no person shall be deprived of life, liberty, or property. No person shall be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. They are absolute in their expressions. They're unconditional in their application. I once had this fairly acrimonious exchange with Joe Klein of Time Magazine. I've actually had many acrimonious exchanges with Joe Klein of Time Magazine, but This one in particular that I'm thinking of took place in 2008 or 2009, and it was an argument about civil liberties. I don't recall the specifics, but it went on for a couple of weeks, and it became very kind of confrontational, and it involved the exchange of lots of accusatory statements. And in the middle of it, he wrote something and said, I think what's driving all of this, the key thing to realize about why this dispute has arisen is that Glenn Greenwald is a civil liberties extremist. And honestly, what happened was when I read that statement by him, I was actually really bewildered because I thought to myself, you know, I don't understand this. We're having this extremely vituperative exchange. We're saying all sorts of horrible things about each other, and all of a sudden in the middle, he just stopped and decided to lavish this incredible praise on me. Like, I'm a civil liberties extremist. And it took me a few minutes, and then I realized, oh wait, actually no, when he says that, he actually means that that's like a bad thing. And the reason that was so confusing to me was because civil liberties extremist is in essence the greatest compliment that someone can pay you. And the reason I say that is because there is no way to defend liberties without being extreme about it. There is no way to express fealty to these rights that I just described without insisting upon their application to everyone equally and in all circumstances. The minute you start justifying pragmatic waivers of them or exceptions to be made for pragmatic considerations is the minute that you cease to believe in them. And what I think is so critical about this concept of civil liberties and the specific expressions of it that it finds in our Bill of Rights, in our Constitution, is that if you look at the state of the United States, and you've heard about this all day, including from Professor Aziz just now, what you find are not isolated case-by-case violations of them. What you find are fundamental and systematic repudiations of these rights. So if you look at the history over the last decade of the way in which American Muslims have been prosecuted for, quote, material support for terrorism, what you find is that they've been targeted and prosecuted based not on acts that they've undertaken, but on beliefs that they've expressed. If you look at the sprawling surveillance state that has been erected, in which all of our activities are monitored and reported and stored in government databases without any indication that we've done anything wrong, let alone a showing of probable cause that we have, it is as complete and pure a violation of the Fourth Amendment as it gets. And if you look at the system of indefinite detention, of putting people in cages, often for life, without even a pretense of any charge, or what we have now, which is targeting people, including American citizens, for execution, for extrajudicial assassination, in total secrecy, without charges, oversight of any kind, that is as profound and complete a repudiation of the Fifth Amendment's guarantee against the deprivation of life or liberty without due process of law. This is a systematic violation of these liberties, not isolated case-by-case basis. And what's most striking about it to me is that as we move further away from the precipitating pretext, which is the attack of 9/11, what one finds is that these violations become more acute. They continue to increase rather than recede. And so what I want to do is just spend a few minutes asking two questions about the state of affairs. One of which is, why has this happened? Why has it been allowed to happen with relatively little backlash and resistance of the type that we've convened here today to generate? And secondly, what are the primary implications of allowing these sorts of abuses to continue in such a fundamental way for as long as we allow them to continue? And the reason I think those two questions are so crucial is because only by understanding what causes it and understanding why it's so crucial to stop it, can we ourselves begin to think about how to create strategies for arresting it and convincing our fellow citizens to join us in that effort. So let me begin with that first question, which is, why has this all happened? Why have we allowed this to happen? And I think there are a few reasons why this has taken place and why it's been so difficult to combat it. What are the impediments? The first of which is that all of this is taking place in the context of war. And not just a war against a specific country, but a war against multiple countries on the planet. The reason that's so significant is because it is always the case, historically in every society it is the case, that in times of war, that is when the power of political leaders is most unconstrained. 2,000 years ago, Cicero said, when men pick up arms, the law falls mute. There are no limits, or very few limits, that can be effectively applied to political leaders when they're prosecuting and waging a war. That was why it was supposed to be so difficult under the Constitution for wars to be commenced, because of the threat that they pose to our core liberties. And what's most amazing about the quote-unquote war which we're currently fighting is that, unlike prior wars in American history that have justified civil liberties abuses, which ended when those wars ended, so Abraham Lincoln's suspension of habeas corpus ended when the Civil War did, Franklin Roosevelt's internment of Japanese Americans, they were liberated once World War II was over, this war by design can have no end. It is designed to be an internal and permanent war. Just 2 weeks ago, the Washington Post reported that the Obama administration is in the process of codifying its quote-unquote kill lists by creating what the administration is calling a disposition matrix, a matrix that analyzes algorithms to determine how you should be disposed of. Should you be put into prison indefinitely without charges? Should you be killed? Should you be charged with a crime? And the premise of this system, said the Washington Post, was that Obama administration officials are acting on the premise that the quote-unquote war on terror will take place for at least another decade, which means that it will have lasted longer than 20 years. And when you talk about a war that lasts for 20 years, you're no longer talking about a finite, discrete event that ushers in civil liberties abridgments that end when the wars do. You're talking about a fundamental and radical transformation of the kind of government we have. The other aspect of war that makes it so difficult to combat civil liberties abridgments is that one of the crucial strategies of war on the part of every government is to dehumanize the group against whom violence is being applied. And the reason that's so crucial is because no population, other than the most sociopathic, would tolerate years and years and years of continuous lethal force applied to a foreign population unless the humanity of that population has been obscured and hidden and denied, unless they've become dehumanized. And this war has involved the lethal application of force against almost exclusively one group of people, which are Muslims. And although the government and its officials will explicitly say that we're not at war against Muslims generally or against Islam, the theory, which is that every time the US government imprisons somebody without charges or kills somebody, that it should be assumed, without evidence being presented, without due process being afforded, that those people somehow deserve it, that they're militants or terrorists or whatever other labels the government and the media slap upon them reflexively. The theory has created the idea in the minds of the population by design that this group of people, American Muslims, or Muslims generally, are collectively guilty, that they're really not human in the way that we would object if any other group of human beings were being treated in this manner. And this dual approach of war, heightening the power of political leaders at the same time dehumanizing the group which is targeted, makes it very difficult to combat rights abridgments because of the idea that anything the government does in its name is probably justified. The second reason why this is so difficult to combat and why this has been allowed to happen is related to the first. Professor Aziz talked a lot about this, other speakers today have as well, so I'm just going to touch upon it. It is the idea that because these abuses are only happening to one small marginalized group of people, that there really is no reason for most other people to be concerned about it, that you can be indifferent to it or even supportive of it. And I think, you know, it's easy to mock that idea. It's easy to condemn other people for thinking that because these rights abuses aren't affecting them, that they can somehow forget about it or be even supportive of it. But I think it's important to recognize just how potent of a strategy that is, how it can affect all of us, including people who are otherwise sympathetic to these issues. So I know lots of people who will read the things I write, who read about these injustices, who will say, look, I agree with you, these things are horrible. But deep in their minds, they know that when they wake up tomorrow morning, because they're not Muslim, because they're white, that it is extremely unlikely that they're going to be abducted and taken to Guantanamo or put in a cage without charges. They know it's extremely unlikely that a drone will be sent over their house with a cruise missile launch that blows up their house and their children. So it's very easy to deprioritize these issues, even if we think they're injustices, and to believe that they don't really require as much urgency as others that might affect us more directly. And aside from the obvious moral reason that I think nobody in this room needs to know, the sign, the motto of the conference is, an injury to one is an injury to all, aside from that moral precept, which is incredibly compelling, it is the case that it is just incredibly misguided to think in that way from a practical or pragmatic standpoint, because it is always the case, not sometimes, not usually, but always the case, that civil liberties abridgments, abuses of core rights, extend beyond their original application to all sorts of unanticipated groups. And you can look at the history of the Patriot Act over the last 10 years, which has been applied overwhelmingly in 85% of the cases to matters having nothing to do with terrorism. Or you look at the FBI strategy of creating their own plots and financing their own plots and luring people into their own plots, and then at the last minute heroically breaking up their own plots and then announcing to the world how grateful we should be that they've kept us safe and yet again broken up their own plot. That tactic is now being applied to anarchist activists, to people protesting NATO policies, to, as Professor Aziz said, to the Occupy movement. And what we see most of all, and I think most perniciously of all, is the importation of war on terror tactics from what was once confined to foreign soil into domestic soil. So if you listen to US national security officials who 10 years ago and 8 years ago and even 5 years ago were saying that the greatest threat to American national security was Al-Qaeda, what they now say is that the greatest threat to national security are what they call, quote, homegrown terrorists. And so you see the civil liberties abuses of the last several years being directed not outward to foreign nationals, but inward domestically to American citizens. That's what the dilution of Miranda rights are about for people taken in on and arrested on US soil. It's what the NDAA is designed to do, which is to codify the power of indefinite detention on US soil. It's what the paramilitarization of our local and state police forces based on tactics perfected in Baghdad is designed to do. It's what the increasingly rapid importation of drones is all about. Drones are coming to the United States. They are already in use for surveillance capabilities in numerous American cities by numerous local police departments. It is inevitable that they will spread not just for surveillance, but also for weaponized purposes. You see this importation of what was once something we could convince ourselves was confined to foreign soil, increasingly into domestic soil, and finding ways to convince our fellow citizens that we all have an equal stake in combating these abridgments is, in my view, of the highest priority in terms of combating them. Earlier, there was a speaker who was an official with the Electric Union, John Woodruff, who spoke, and I wish everyone could hear what he said, not just in this room, but everywhere, because he talked about how civil liberties abridgments are a core issue for the labor movement. And the reason that he gave was that any organization that wants to agitate against those in power has an equal stake in protecting these liberties, is equally endangered when they're assaulted. That's true not just of the labor movement, but of every single political activist group that is trying to accomplish change in the United States. That is what civil liberties is about. It's why an abridgment for one person is abridgment for everyone. The third reason that I think it's so difficult to combat these things, it has been so hard, and the reason why we've been allowing it to happen is because of the role that partisan allegiance plays in all of this. Professor Aziz talked about the fear-mongering campaign that has been incredibly effective, but so too is the role that partisan loyalty has. There's this incredible report, which you can find online, which I would urge you to go read. It's a 2008 report that was prepared by the CIA at the height of the general election between John McCain and Barack Obama. And what prompted the CIA report that was written in secret and ultimately leaked to WikiLeaks, which published it, was the concern that anti-war sentiment was spreading in Western Europe, and it had actually caused the fall of two Western European governments that were supportive of the war in Afghanistan, and the CIA was petrified that if this anti-war sentiment continued to spread, it would compel the withdrawal of troops from every government in Western Europe, and ultimately it would spread to the United States. And what this report concluded was that the only real weapon against the spreading anti-war sentiment, the only tool that could really be a good, effective antidote would be the election of Barack Obama. And the reason, said the CIA report, why that would happen was because if Obama was elected, it would replace, as the face of American wars, this swaggering evangelical cowboy that the world had come to hate and replace it with a much softer, more sophisticated, educated, urbane, progressive constitutional lawyer that would then transform huge numbers of war opponents into people who view these wars as humanitarian. And that CIA report was incredibly prescient. Not just in terms of being able to sustain support for American militarism, but also to ensure that even greater amounts of support for this rights assault was prevalent in the United States. And I know this from my own experience. I've been speaking about civil liberties now in the United States for, I don't know, 6 or 7 years. And if I spoke 4 or 5 years ago to a room like this and you just assembled 100 people randomly from the street and I stood up and I denounced all the policies that I've just denounced and I talked about the civil liberties issues I've just spoken about, you would have half of that room of randomly assembled Americans 4 years ago extremely antagonistic to what I was saying, completely hating me. Those were called Republicans because they were very supportive of these policies because they were George Bush and Dick Cheney's policies, but you would have 50% of the room thinking exactly the opposite way. Those were called Democrats. So you have this incredibly divisive citizenry surrounding these issues. 4 years later, if you assemble that same audience and I stand up and I speak about the same exact policies in the same exact way, you'll have 85% of that room hating me, 80% if I'm lucky, and 15 to 20% of the room being supportive because huge numbers of Democrats have now become supportive of the very policies that 4 years ago they were denouncing as right-wing radicalism because it's now a Democratic country. Think about what the real controversies were of the Bush administration that caused huge numbers of Democrats and progressives and even American liberals to run around shrieking about the war that was being waged on the Constitution. It was things like the president's asserted authority to eavesdrop on our conversation without judicial review, or even to detain people without charges. Those kind of controversies almost seem quaint at this point.